Terry Varner, but he is under doctor's orders not to travel and not to speak right now because of an upcoming surgery. The first person I saw after I got that call from Terry was Van Sprague, so I said, Van, you're speaking Monday, 1:15, or something like that. I asked him if he would, and he graciously consented to do so. I don't have a written biography of Van, but I know a lot about him. He's a dear friend of our families. He's been an incredible influence on our son in his maturing in Christ, as well as some other people, including some of our present and our future students. He is good at taking people where they are and moving them toward where they need to be, in personal evangelistic settings and in public settings. He knows his Bible. He's excited about his Bible. He's excited about sharing the gospel with people. He is married to the former Jennifer Nolan of Parkersburg, West Virginia, and they have two daughters, Victoria and Isabella. They have one son who is, a month old, something like that? About a month old, Christopher. And we're just tickled to death that Van has agreed to put some quick labor and some intense labor into this lesson and be able to share these thoughts with you today. Van?
Okay, so you can ask this question in your mind, the first question everyone asked when they heard, so you're going to fill in for Terry Monday. You're going to do a Terry impression? I've always been bad at that. Now, after the lesson, I'm sure we could have a line of people who'd be happy to give you their best impression of Terry Varner. But to be perfectly clear this afternoon, I'm not here to take Terry's place whatsoever. I'm here to speak during his time slot. It takes a lifetime of dedication to God to be a Terry Varner. And boy, don't we need Terry Varners. It takes a lifetime of dedication to God to be Charles Pugh, to be a Denver Cooper, and a Frank Higginbotham. And I wish one of those were standing here because I'd love to sit at their feet. Even more than usual, I'm humbled to be able to have this opportunity. And my prayer is I'd feel the same sense of gravity and importance any time I'd get behind a pulpit. And that's my exhortation for any preachers this afternoon for that. We have a grave responsibility and a great one in what we do. And I'm really glad to be able to be here and do that. So if things are working well, yes, there we go. You'll remember probably in about August 27th, there was landfall of a hurricane in North Carolina that really ravaged the seacoast up to New York before it became a tropical storm. It caused $15.7 billion in damage. It put 7 million people out of electricity and killed dozens. And if you're on top of this, you probably say, well, I know that hurricane. That was Hurricane Irene. And the interesting thing about Hurricane Irene, because we name all of our hurricanes, is that it comes from a Greek word that we have in our New Testament that's translated peace. We named a hurricane peace. Now, doesn't that just sound like our world sometimes, right? And it really makes me think of places like Jeremiah chapter 6, verse 14, where Jeremiah is speaking to a people that are denying that there's any destruction coming, that they've done anything really worthy of being destroyed. They're still God's people. And he says that these false prophets, they've soothed you a little, saying, peace, peace, when there is no peace. And don't we live in a world like that today? And I'm afraid if we're not so careful that as Christians we can adapt a worldly definition of what peace is. And as we're examining this psalm today, I want to take my obligatory moment and thank the lectureship committee for allowing me to speak, and thank them for giving me the psalm. When I read the psalms, God gives me peace as my theme. And I've looked at it in almost 20 English translations, and the word peace is not in here. The word peace isn't in the psalm. And I don't believe that was an accident, because I'm going to give them more credit than that. I really believe there was wisdom in it. As we learn about this psalm and about the heart of David who wrote it, what we find is really the true definition of peace. And as we look at it, my hope is to bring up what we may have tried to present as peace at times, what all of us have probably been guilty of in some form or fashion, and to help us see a more perfect understanding of what it means to be at peace. That way, we are more capable of having peace ourselves, and we can give it to others. And so, as we're looking at this, we come to a psalm that David wrote at one of the more tumultuous times in his life. At one point or other, he was in one cave or another, on one of those times when Saul, the reigning king of Israel, was pursuing him with an army. That's what's going on in the psalm, and this is the psalm that we're looking at when we're examining a piece, and it's the perfect psalm for it as we look at it. And I want you to imagine someone preparing for Hurricane Katrina, and we're looking at this idea of peace that God gives us no matter what's going on around us. They're preparing, and they're probably boarding up their windows. And I would imagine that if I were a person who prepared for a hurricane and I abandoned my home and my possessions and I came back and they'd been destroyed, I'd probably be saying, if I had just covered up my basement better, maybe. Maybe if I had just secured the boards with something else. And I probably would be awfully hard on myself, when the fact of the matter is, there comes a point in any storm that you can't do well enough. You can't save it. It's going to be destroyed. Now, I'm afraid sometimes what we do when we're looking at the idea of peace is just that. We say, if you can handle things well enough in your life, then you can have peace. If you set enough aside for retirement, if you take good enough care of your health, if you're just a nice enough person to those around you, then you're going to be healthy and you're going to be taken care of and you're going to be at peace. We'll even go so far as to talk to the person who is ill and act much like Job's terrible comforters, right? Whenever we look at Job chapter 16, verse 2, these miserable comforters. And I'm afraid sometimes we look at our brother or sister who's suffering and we might say, just trust in God more. As if to say, maybe it's because you're just not doing well enough at making your life peaceful, and that's why you don't have peace. And all of us have done that to a little extent, perhaps. That is not to say, and this is another lesson, that there's not something to that, that there are people who suffer because of things that they're doing wrong. Hebrews chapter 12 speaks to that. 1 Corinthians 11, we see that there are Christians who were suffering sickness because they were partaking of the Lord's Supper in an unworthy manner, right? So that does happen. But what I want us to realize with this first point as we examine the psalm is that our peace is not in relation to our ability. That's not where peace comes from. Our peace is found in the ability of our relationship. What do I mean by that? It's not how good we are at it. It's in the ability of the relationship that comes from God. Sorry, back up. I got ahead of myself. So when we're thinking of this, I'm going to look at Psalm 57, verse 1, and we find right off, he says, be merciful to me, O God. Be merciful to me. Now, how many times does the Bible have to say something to mean it? How many times does a Spirit-led psalmist need to say something to mean it? Just one. What's the idea of this? David's humility and the urgency, the depth from which he's calling for the mercy of God. And you know what? If you're not willing to be merciful, what we find in Scripture is you better not rely on God's mercy. That's obvious, isn't it? When you look at James chapter 2, verse 13, and James says that judgment is without mercy to he who shows no mercy. There is no mercy for that. Whenever Jesus was giving the example prayer in Matthew chapter 6 at the end of it, verses 14 and 15, he makes it very clear after he says to pray, we pray for those who, for our transgressions to be forgiven, that we're forgiven as those who have transgressed against us. And he says, for if you do not forgive men, then God will not forgive you. It's that plain. Now, David here, in verse 1 of this psalm, if I were to put myself in his shoes, I don't know if I honestly could be thinking of mercy in the first verse of the psalm. What about you? Cowering in a cave, running from a kingdom that I know from a prophet is mine someday, from a king that I loved, that I cared for, who tried to kill me more than once already, and here I am. And we don't know which time this is, but it could have been the time where he had the opportunity to kill him in the cave, got so close he cut off part of his garment. It could be the time where he was able to sneak right into the midst of the camp. It shows how devoted those soldiers was, how devoted those soldiers were, doesn't it? And he took his things and he showed him. He could have done it, but he showed him mercy. He was willing to forgive him. And because he was willing to express mercy, he knew about his relationship with God, and he knew he could call on him for mercy. Even more than that, as we continue to look, we find that his trust and reliance in God is why he could have peace. It wasn't because of his lack of ability, because he didn't take care of Saul. It wasn't because he didn't love Jonathan, his son, and he wasn't trying to be the best soon-to-be king that he could be. That wasn't why he couldn't have peace. He wasn't experiencing peace because of the evil in Saul and because of those who were pursuing him. And so we look, how could he have peace then? It was in relation to his relationship with God, because he had a trust in him. As we continue reading in the second part of this verse, verse 1 of Psalm 57, he says, "For my soul trusts in you." It was directly related. You look at Psalm 16:1, and he coordinates these. He says, "Preserve me, O Lord." Well, why would he expect that from God? "For in you I put my trust." Those two things can't be separated. Our peace is directly proportionate to our relationship with God. Not physical peace, but this peace that David could have that we need to strive for. And he knew. He's calling on God to be merciful. His soul trusted in him. In 1 Peter chapter 5, verses 6 and 7, Peter directly ties this idea of humility together with finding comfort in God when he says, "Humble yourself under the mighty hand of God, that you may be exalted in due time, casting your cares upon him, for he cares for you." And so often we quote that second part of the verse, right? And it is truly a comforting verse. Casting your cares on him, for he cares for you. But if every day you're saying, "I've got this, I can get myself out of my own hardships, I can pull myself up by my own bootstraps," just like we might say as a motto of this country, perhaps. And it's an admirable trait in a worldly sense. But no, we're missing the first half of that. Why would we all of a sudden decide, okay, God will take care of me since I've decided I've done everything I can. I can't do it. Instead, we humble ourselves under the mighty hand of God and realizing that I can't do it without him. It doesn't matter how good that I am, I can't make peace in my life. Instead, I've already been trusting in him. I've already humbled myself there, and now I can cast my cares on him and know that he hears me. It has to do with my faithfulness and steadfastness in him. As we go on later in the psalm, he says in verse 7, "My heart is steadfast, O God. My heart is steadfast." Other translations say it's fixed. And when I think of fixed, it's the picture that we find in the psalm. It's not moving. It's stuck there. And I appreciate the language in the New Testament so much, because you find these faithful men of God and they're presented with trials. They're in the face of persecution. And you hear men like Peter when they're told not to preach Jesus anymore. And he says, whether it is right in the sight of God to listen to you more than to God, you judge. And then this little word that we read right over, "for I cannot." Literally, he's saying, I don't have the power. I'm stuck. Because of what I know, there's nothing else I can do. I cannot but speak the things which I have seen and heard. And that's the idea of what David's saying here. This is it. There's no other option for me. Like Peter said in John chapter 6, who else has the words of life, right? To Jesus, where else am I going to go? That's the attitude he had. And since there was nowhere else he was going to go, when he was presented with that temptation, I could kill him right now. Nobody would know. I get in my problems. I could take what's my rightful place as king. He said, I can't harm the Lord's anointed. If I hurt God's anointed, if I'm fighting against God, then I've left the only place that I can be. So our peace is not in relation to our ability. It's directly related to the ability of our relationship with God. Now, that's closely related to this next idea. Whenever we look at the world in which we live, isn't this really what we're looking for peace? People want these clear skies and bright sunshine and calm waters. People often want to say, run to a beach trip, and they say, I just want to get away from it all, right? They don't get any peace until their next vacation, until they might get a break from the children, until they might get a reprieve from their health condition. And whenever we get that, that's what oftentimes we call peace, isn't it? Now, the images that you see are beautiful, but they're actually taken from the center of Hurricane Irene, of Hurricane Peace. Now, that doesn't seem like a great place to be, does it? But I want you to imagine the world's idea of peace. Too often our idea of peace, of saying, okay, I'm going to try to stay in the center of this hurricane we call life, because hard things are happening. Everything's swirling around. It gets chaotic. But the center of this, it's just calm and serene, and I want to stay there. And what's going to happen? Just like these storm chasers, you're going to have to run all the time. You're never going to be able to stop moving. You're constantly going to be worrying about the next way you can stay in that calm place, because the storm's coming. And what about when you come to the edge of the ocean and you have no boat? What about when you come to a mountain that you can't climb? That's it. And there's going to be a time where the storm catches up with you. And as we look at Scripture, the idea of peace is not in the absence of strife. It's in the presence of God. And that's why David could have peace. That's why the nation's army could be after him. To put it in perspective, have many of us been chased by the nation's army? Don't raise your hand. But the nation's army was after him. And he could be at peace. And it wasn't because there was no strife. It was because of his relationship with God. When we look back at Psalm 51, in the second half of verse 1, he says, "And in the shadow of your wings I will make my refuge." Now, what's that referring to? Anyone who's perhaps raised chickens, you see the hen, the mama hen, and you run after her chicks for a moment, and if she doesn't get you, she gets them, right? And what does that mean? Well, she's either going to claw you, or she's going to gather them under her wings. She's protecting them. Does that mean there's no threat anymore? No. The threat's right there, but their mama's got them. And guess what she's going to be willing to give for them? Everything. Till she can't do anything else. Those chicks are safe underneath of her wing. And it's a picture that you find throughout Scripture. Also, you find it in the Psalms. And whenever you look on into Matthew chapter 23, verse 37, Jesus is lamenting. He's looking at a city that's betrayed him, and all he's wanted to do is give his life to protect them and to give them peace. And he says that he would gather them as a mother hen, as a hen would gather chicks underneath of his wings. But they wouldn't do it. And as we look at David here, he knew that he could have peace because he was under the loving protection of his father. He was under the loving protection of God. And though there was a storm outside, he wasn't trying to just find the calm place. He had the calm place within his relationship with God. Further, he knew that he had salvation through God. As you keep on reading in verse 3, he says, "He shall send from heaven and save me, and reproach the one who would swallow me up, Salah." Now, to take a moment on this word Salah, very briefly, we might say we don't know what it means, so we're guessing. And since scholars far more familiar with it than I say, not so sure about this, I'm not going to give you anything definitive, but look at something within this psalm. It appears twice in verse 3 and in verse 6. And there's a similarity in the subject. Whenever you look, he's being persecuted here. He's being mistreated. And in verse 3, it says, "He, God, reproaches the one who would swallow me up, who is panting after me. They're so passionate against me in their rage, it's as if they're chasing me like a dog." And isn't that how Paul's described as pursuing the Christians in Acts chapter 9? He panted after the Christians. He was breathing hard in order to pursue them and to kill them. And that's his pursuers. But God reproached them. You go down to verse 7 where we see Salah again. Verse 6, rather. And the second part of the verse, he says, they have dug a pit before me, into the midst of it they themselves have fallen. So David, in these two verses, says, they're reproaching me, but you're going to reproach them, God. And then he says, they're setting up a trap for me, but they're going to fall into it. You see that he's dealing with the fall of his enemies, that God's going to save them. And here's just a suggestion. I highlight that, a suggestion. This is not what I know Salah to mean, but when you're reading through the Psalms on your own, try this. When you come to the word Salah, read that phrase again. When we're looking at the idea, it means reflect on this. Actually, read it again. Use it almost like a repeat in the music. We sing those hymns, and the end of them end in such a way where we say, okay, let's sing the end of that again. And treat it like that and see what it does for your reading, your study of the Psalms. Again, I'm not saying that's what it means. What I'm saying is it very well may be a good way to meditate as we look at it. But this idea of pause, reflect on it, try reading again. But you see, David relied on God for his salvation from heaven. He didn't rely on himself. Vengeance is mine. I will repay, says the Lord. And David had that here. Even though he had the opportunity for vengeance, he didn't take it. And in that, in this relationship with God, he found peace despite the turmoil. And further, he goes on and he recognizes God's fidelity. God's truthfulness is how he could find comfort no matter what was going on. When we continue to look on in verse 3, he says, God shall send forth his mercy and his truth. In verse 1, he said, be merciful to me. And then here we are in verse 3, and he's not doubting it. God will send his mercy and his truth. There's no doubt about it. And that's why he could find peace. Well, why is that so important, God's fidelity? Because you know what? This life is tumultuous. There are heartaches at every turn. And if we choose just to see those in despair and we don't look past them, then we lose sight of God. But the fact is, we can look to the promise of Scripture. And we can know from point one, like we talked about, my relationship with God, I'm trusting in him. I'm faithful to him. I'm doing what I can in my service to him. And therefore, looking at his promises, it might not seem like it. Everything may seem like it's going wrong, but I trust in his mercy. I know he's going to care for me, even though I don't see it. But I've seen it here over and over again, and I believe that it'll happen for me. And as we look at our life in Christ, we can say, what am I striving for? Have I ever avoided a discussion about the Bible because I just don't want to cause a problem? And someone might say, after all, we're supposed to be peacemakers, right? Do you think we have the idea of peacemaking correct? Did God come to this world to teach us how to be at peace with all people? Or did Christ die to make us at peace with God? And when we get our peacemaking job correct, then we're more on top of it, because as we read about it, we find Jesus in Luke 19, 41 through 44, after he's been rejected, his triumphal entry. He's riding on a colt of a donkey, and he's coming into the city. And here's something. Why was he doing that? Because a king riding a donkey, he's saying, it's peace. There's peace. He came to bring peace. But they rejected him. The leaders rejected him. And then he says, oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, if you'd just known what would make for peace. But you know what they thought would make for peace? We're going to stick with the Pax Romana. That is, we're going to keep the Roman peace. We don't want to upset the Roman government through an insurrection. And besides Jesus, they said basically, we don't think you're the king that could overtake Rome. And that's what they wanted. They wanted Rome overtaken because they thought if they could have some solitude and quiet, that that would bring them peace. And by avoiding conflict with Rome, they were going to have peace. But no, holding on to their Savior, despite all odds, even if Rome would come and destroy them, that would have brought them peace. And lo and behold, in less than 40 years, they were going to be destroyed. They weren't going to find the peace that they sought after because they rejected the very one who could have brought them peace. And so often, in our running to try to get peace, the peace of the world, what we do is we compromise. We don't take action when we should because we're afraid of causing strife. and we're missing opportunities to bring people into peace with God. But Paul is very clear in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 12, after he's talked about Timothy following his example. And he says, yes, and all who desire to live godly will suffer persecution. In 1 Peter chapter 3 and 4, Peter gives a great balance there, because certainly we don't need to be going out into the world and causing trouble. That's not the point at all. We also don't want to be the troublemakers in the world. If you hear the headline of a Christian, it shouldn't be a headline about some law that they've broken. What it should be a headline about is about our service in Christ. And by the way, I'm not making any political commentary. There's way too much to get into there. I'm just talking about what Peter's talking about here in 1 Peter chapters 3 and 4. In chapter 3, he says something that should be very clear in verse 13. And who is he who will harm you if you become followers of what is good? But the Holy Spirit knew better than that. There are going to be people who harm people for doing good. He says in verse 14, but even if you should suffer for righteousness' sake, you are blessed, and do not be afraid of their threats nor be troubled. You go on into chapter 4, and in verse 12 he says, beloved, do not think it strange concerning the fiery trial, which is to try you as though some strange thing has happened to you. When's the last time you've had a fiery trial? And I don't mean because of something you've done wrong, and boy, I shouldn't have said that. I'm going to pay. I should have controlled my anger. I don't mean that. Look at what he says. But rejoice to the extent that you partake of Christ's sufferings, that when his glory is revealed, you may also be glad with exceeding joy. You see, Acts chapter 5, verse 41 is when Peter was beaten, rebuked, and told not to preach Christ. And he went away rejoicing that he was worthy to suffer in the name of Christ. This man practiced what he preached. What was he doing? He was preaching the truth and love. He was preaching the gospel, and he was beaten for it. This is what he's talking about. That's what you glory in. He says in verse 14, if you are reproached for the name of Christ, blessed are you, for the spirit of glory and of God rests upon you. On their part he is blasphemed, but on your part he is glorified. But let none of you suffer as a murderer, a thief, an evildoer, or as a busybody in other people's matters. You see the line? But boy, if you suffer because they're hurting you, they're pursuing you because you're just teaching the truth, because you love them too much to let them go into eternity, not at peace with God, you're willing to give up your peace with mankind, that's why we suffer. And that's the type of peace that David had. And when you look at Luke chapter 6, verse 26, Jesus pronounces a woe upon those who would be in a good relationship with all men. Because that might say something about your stand for the truth, because the false prophets got along pretty well with everybody as well. But Jesus is the only one who can bring peace. And as we understand that better, what we find is that this one, Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6, the one who is the Prince of Peace, but also the one in Matthew chapter 10, verse 34, that said, I came not to bring peace, but a sword. And you say, well, which is it? He came to bring peace with God. And it's going to necessarily cause division between any men who will not be at peace with God. Now, that comes to our last point, and probably one of the biggest things that hit me in reflecting on this psalm over the last week. And that is this idea. How many people, when this hurricane's coming, really benefit by closing their ears and closing their eyes and saying, la, 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 I don't want to hear it. No, no, there's no hurricane coming. Don't tell me about a hurricane. And you know, there are some people who do act like that. They ignore the calls to flee. They don't prepare their house, and they're destroyed because they're trying to ignore it. And now when we see a child do that, we laugh and we say, oh, that's childish. Why do we do it? They do it because they don't want to hear what they're being told. They're going to ignore it. And you know, isn't that sort of one way we look at peace sometimes? Act as if it's not a big deal. Act as if there's no problem. We almost make peace into that which you can read from a Hallmark card. And what I mean is, and please try not to do this to your brothers and sisters who are suffering loss, suffering heartache, suffering sickness, suffering financial ruin, and they're doing everything they can to say, it's not a big deal. God will take care of all of it. Is it true that God can take care of it? Yes, it is. But don't tell them it's not a big deal. One thing you see in this psalm and in so many other writings of David and other sufferers in Scripture is they didn't find peace in minimizing their difficulties. They found peace in maximizing God. They were realists. They knew we have a problem. Jesus said to those who would follow him, well, he wanted to make sure that they knew, the foxes have holes and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. He didn't say, oh, it's easy, follow me. And you say, oh, whoa, whoa, but you have him saying, come you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest and take my yoke upon you. It's easy. He didn't mean there's no difficulty in following him. Whenever we look at it, what was the yoke that they were holding? They were holding the burden, the crushing burden, which no one can bear, of sin. And he was going to take that from them. And then they were going to have a yoke that they actually could carry. And what was going to make it possible? Because they were going to be yoked with Christ. And so minimizing the difficulties doesn't bring peace. And maybe you've been doing that. Look at what David did back in Psalm 56. You look at verse 4, and he says, my soul is among lions. I lie among the sons of men who are set on fire, whose teeth are spears and arrows, and their tongue a sharp sword. Go back up to verse 1. And he says, in the shadow of your wings I make my refuge until these calamities have passed by. Now, here's where I want to modify our thinking more specifically to where this psalm's coming from. Because if we miss this, we miss the whole point. I've mentioned a lot about what we're going to call incidental difficulties in our life. And what I mean is someone getting sick. That's not evil. Getting sick isn't evil. Certainly it's suffering. And certainly we shouldn't minimize that. Losing our jobs, death, that in and of itself isn't evil. Those are things that cause us heartaches and hardships in life. Specifically, the strife in Psalm 57 is evil. And why do I say that? The English Standard Version translates this, for David to be under the shadow of God's wing until the storms have passed by. And I liked that at first, but as I learned about this word calamities, I sort of withdrew from it, because the storms is as if these hard things that happen to everybody in life. But really, when you look at this word calamities, it happens 16 times in the Old Testament, 8 of which are in the book of Psalms. Over half the times that this word comes up in the New Testament, in the Old Testament, it's actually directly related with evil speaking and evil schemes. And I wanted to bring that up because in the context of this psalm, that understanding's perfect. Why was David suffering? Look back now at verse 4, and he says, my soul is among the lions. He's dealing with the ferocity, how passionately, again, they're trying to devour them. We recognize that verse, don't we? Whenever we look back over at 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8, that our adversary, the devil, this is why we need to be sober, be vigilant. Your adversary, the devil, he stalks about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour, swallow up all at once. And that's the passion, the fervor with which they were pursuing him. But look at how it goes on. The men who are set on fire could have an idea to do with the passion, could have to do with the fierceness. He said, whose teeth are spears and arrows, and their tongue is a sharp sword. Now, we find that people, when they hear news they don't want to hear, they gnash at you with their teeth, don't they? From Acts chapter 7. But also our teeth, our tongues. Who else do we hear of who has a tongue as a sharp sword? Well, we read of the symbolic Christ in the book of Revelation. And what did that sword represent? It represented his word. And isn't that what everybody's tongue represents? Not God's word here, by any means, but their words. Their words were deadly. We have a saying, sticks and stones may break my bones, but words will never hurt me. I encourage you to show me about a war that never began with words, that didn't begin with a written or spoken communication. Words cause war. Words cause wounds. Words can be evil. And so what we're dealing with here isn't a sickness, though David writes about that in Psalms as well, doesn't he? What we're dealing with here is planned intent, maliciousness, evil. And why was David suffering this evil? Not for anything he had done. He was even doing good things, remember. But that's the type of evil that we're talking about. And this is why I wanted to bring this up. Because if you walk away from this psalm and you say, as I've said before, oh boy, I'm glad I don't have a king chasing me. I don't have to worry about ever having an army and being stuck in a cave. That would be hard. Then we've missed it. Because here's the fact of the matter. You look at places like 2 Corinthians chapter 10, and you learn Paul the apostle as he's trying to explain the true warfare that's going on. And he says in verse 3, for though we walk in the flesh, we do not war according to the flesh. We may never have a physical army pursuing us, but listen to this. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty in God for pulling down strongholds, casting down arguments. Arguments, words. Words that do what? Words that communicate evil, that communicate thoughts, plans that are contrary to God. He says, arguments and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing to every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. We're fighting a non-physical warfare. You look at Ephesians chapter 6. We're familiar with that as a chapter that has this armor in it, the godly armor, the whole armor of God. And why do we have that? Look just before he goes on describing the armor, and he says in verse 11, put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. And again, wiles, we're dealing with plans, evil schemes. Satan's plan, his game book, to say, how do I bring you down and consume you so you're never the fruitful tree of God that God would want you to be? And he goes on and says, for we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. And if we understand what that verse is saying, it should put a healthy fear in us. And it should make us realize that if there were even one moment on this earth, if it weren't for God's presence, we wouldn't stand a chance. Without the armor of God as a Christian, without the sacrifice of Christ on the cross for us, there would be absolutely no hope. It wouldn't matter how much energy that we put into it. We could not have peace because we couldn't be reunited with God. Satan, his hosts of wickedness, would crush us. And they're every bit as and more intimidating than any army that anyone could muster. That's what we need to get from the psalm. But that's not what we rely on, that we're away from these calamities. But the fact is that we can have a relationship with God. The fact is that we can rely on the shelter of his wing, and that though the storm is there, we're not trying to stay in the most calm and peaceful place, but we assert ourselves in the work that God has given us to do. Whenever we look at 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 4, he says, a good soldier does not entangle himself in the worries of this life, that he may please the one who enlisted him. And we say, you know what, I'm not here for me to find some quiet corner to get a good retirement. I'm not here for me to just be healthy and live until I die. While we should be good stewards and we set aside for those things, I have a spiritual mission. And I know about these spiritual hosts of wickedness, and they're not going to catch me off guard, and I'm not going to run away from them. But wearing the full armor of God, I'm going to face them. I'm going to face them with the power and the strength, the spirit of strength that God has given us through his word. And we can do that. And we can find peace in it knowing they're guarded by those things, being clothed in Christ's righteousness, that Satan can't do a thing to us. We can rejoice in our trials and our suffering, knowing that the trying of our faith produces patience. And you know what? Isn't that amazing? We serve a God that no matter how hard things get in this life, all it can do is make us stronger if we hold closer to him. That's peace.